Welcome to The Solar Truth. I'm Adam Evans, and I'm going to be talking today about how batteries can actually save you money. So batteries have always been kind of an interesting situation with solar. A lot of people have gotten them in the past for backup situations. They either are a prepper or, preparing for the Armageddon or something, or they, just want to kind of be more grid independent. That was okay. There's a lot of different battery options out there. A lot of people are just familiar with the Tesla Powerwall, maybe, which hasn't even been around that long. But and the first version couldn't even go off grid. Like it would store energy and return it when you're on the grid, but that doesn't really do much for people unless your utility doesn't give you any credit for stored energy. So which is we'll get into in a bit, called net energy metering, where your meter can spin backwards. So battery systems like that, you might have a pile of lead acid batteries in the garage and a couple of different inverters and controls transformers and shutoff devices or transfer switches to power different things. So now though, grid outages are pretty common, especially Southern California. You got fires, you got wind, you got different situations where some people are getting their power shut off multiple times a month for multiple days. I mean, it's pretty crazy. So it's kind of a perfect storm now because, a lot of people want batteries just for backup power and just so they can have the refrigerator and internet and some utilities running when the grid does go out. But can it actually save you money too? If it can save you money and you can do backup power, it's amazing. And it can actually work really well for a lot of people. So that gets us into how batteries can work with solar. First, this will be a little bit specific for California. It applies to pretty much all utilities and states and countries. But I'm most familiar with California, and I'll talk about how it'll work with when you don't have net energy metering. So first, what is net energy metering? So I installed solar in my house 10 years ago, 10 or 11 years ago now, and I had what's called net energy metering 1.0. So when you send a permit, like when you get your solar finaled, when it's installed and you get a final permit from your city or county, then it is sent to, or should be sent to, Southern California Edison or whatever utility company you have. And then they flip a switch and turn net energy metering on. So net energy metering basically just allows your meter to spin backwards. And then it shows up on your bill as a different way to show your credit reflected for how much solar production you have versus how much energy you're using outside of that. So you're using energy at night because your solar's not working, but then your meter might be spinning backwards during the day when you're not home and your solar's cranking and there's not much on, besides your refrigerator and stuff. So net energy 1.0 in specifically Edison was really great. And I'm grandfathered into it for 20 years. I get full credit for the solar power.
Mexico, all's I'm saying.
So it's kind of like dollar for dollar. If you produce a certain amount during the day and then you use a certain amount during the night, I actually get more than full credit. I don't pay for that nighttime production. My credit fully applies to it. Plus, my credit during the day is more. So I have a 75% solar system, and I get paid back by Edison. It was really good back then. It was also a little more expensive to do solar back then. But there was also a tax grant and tax credit, so it kind of levelized the cost. But I did get grandfathered in, which is great. So then July 1st, 2017 came around, and Edison reached over 5% solar. They started worrying about too much solar coming into the grid. They had to upgrade the infrastructure, and they actually had a cap at 5%. But before that cap hit, the California Public Utility Commission lifted that cap and had them increase that to 10%. With that became they moved to NEM 2.0. So NEM 2.0, now you have to pay a little bit for your production at night, even if you produced enough to cover it during the day. So you don't get as good of an exchange rate with solar. They also increased the minimum. I pay a dollar a month. They increased that minimum service charge to $10 a month, because the way net energy metering works is they don't want you paying them 1 month and them paying you the next month. So the utility companies will just have you pay a minimum service charge. And then at the end of the year, either you will pay them or they'll pay you. So, you know, that minimum went up to $10 to $12. And pretty soon there will be NEM 3.0. And, you know, the minimum might be $30 to $50, a lot more. So even if you do 100% solar, you know, you're still going to be paying Edison or the utility company a bit. This leads to kind of what happened in Hawaii. You should definitely check out a video. Hawaii is a whole other situation of its own. But about 5 years ago, 2013-14, Hawaii pretty much banned solar. You know, people had to wait about 2 to 3 years to get a permit for solar because the grid couldn't handle the amount of solar that was going on there because it was so popular. So then in 2015-16, they ended up letting you do solar, but now you have to get a battery. You can't, the NEM stopped. So net energy metering was basically went away. So you don't get any credit for your solar production now. In fact, you're not allowed to send solar back to the grid. So you have to have a battery that takes that solar power. So make sure you check that video and it explains that a lot more. But how do batteries relate to NEM basically? Well, you have the problem with the grid over the last 10 years is called the California duck curve. And normally you have a normal curve where, you know, the energy goes up and kind of up and down, lowest point during the at night. And then, you know, the peak would be about 4 to 6 p.m., you know, in the hot evenings and stuff. Well, the more and more solar that's happened every year, that gets lower and lower. And this is, you know, what led to Hawaii problems. And it's led to the time of use rates in California. Because if the solar production gets to such a level that you have so much during the day and people aren't using it, then you could have grid damage. You know, you could have possibly transformers exploding and you know, all kinds of crazy stuff happening. So utility companies avoid those problems by limiting solar and actually they went to time use rates. So they're charging about 300 to 400% more during the peak hours, 4 to 9 p.m. now, because that is the problem with the duck curve. That head, you know, it spikes up, solar stops working, people are still using a lot of power. So utility companies really have a hard time ramping that power up super fast to these high levels when the solar was providing a lot of that power during the day and now isn't. So basically batteries balance this out. Batteries will store the energy during the day when the solar is producing power, and then they'll power your home at night or in the evening, 4 to 9 p.m. specifically, to lower that peak point and kind of flatten that duck curve out, which is what the utilities want. So batteries are really kind of a solution to this problem. And you do need solar with batteries. Solar is required to charge batteries. You're not allowed to charge it from the grid in most utility companies. You know, batteries are kind of made for solar anyway. So you can either get battery with a solar system initially, or you can add a battery on later to an existing solar system. And basically what happens is it's energy arbitrage. So you can save money because you're charging your battery when the electricity is kind of at its low rate. So you're buying low, you know, kind of like stocks, and then you're selling high when it's at its high rate because you're using that energy for your house instead of paying Edison. Now you're using that energy and into the night, so you might avoid some of those non-bypassable charges at night too that you're getting with NEM 2.0 or later. So basically the 4 to 9 rate, for example, with Edison, energy, it costs about 37 to 45 cents a kilowatt at the high rates. And then the rest of the day, it's around 20 to 24 cents a kilowatt. So what you're doing is your battery will generally discharge at about 4 p.m. Throughout the night all the way to 10 a.m. in the morning, depending on how much battery, how big your battery is, how much power it has, and how far it can discharge and stuff. So then in the morning, and you're getting, most of that time, you're getting you're avoiding those high rates, you know, during that time. So then in the morning, it starts charging again at 10 a.m. up to 4 p.m. So your battery gets kind of fully charged generally by noon to 2 o'clock, depending on how low it had drained and how big of a solar system you have. And then it stops charging, you know, at 3 or 4 o'clock, and then we'll go into discharge again. So it repeats that cycle every day, just saving you more money every day. So, you know, basically you don't have to do quite as much solar now. You can do a little bit less than you would have to if you didn't have to have a battery. So you're saving that money, and the battery is saving you more money. So generally the savings on a battery now could be, you know, 6 to 10 years. Kind of depends on the utility, how much energy you're using, and what you would have had to do if you didn't have that battery. So, you know, batteries generally take a little bit longer than solar to pay for themselves, but you do get the tax credit on it as well. That is also kind of going down at over the last few years and ending in a couple years. And then you're saving that money and also have it available for backup. So that's kind of the additional benefit, is your comfort and your lifestyle. Not only is it kind of paying for itself and able to save money with the battery, but now you have a backup load too if the power does go out, and you know, or if you just don't, or, you know, have a little bit more peace of mind to avoid those issues and have backup power to power, you know, whatever you kind of want. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Depending on your size of battery and what battery you get. So yeah, that's how it can save you money. And, you know, generally battery systems, you know, costs are kind of variable depending on the size. But I would say the average cost of a battery system is about $11,000 to $14,000 installed, which is, you know, fairly expensive. But those are generally pretty big battery systems, because that's what you need to power those loads in the evening and overnight. And then you're getting 30% tax credit. So, you know, there was a battery rebate. It's kind of on the wait list, probably not really available anymore. It was, you know, $3,000 to $4,000. So your net cost could have been like $4,000 or $5,000. Now with the tax credit, around $7,000 or $8,000 or so. So that money can actually pay back. You can get paid that back pretty quickly, you know, 6 to 10 years in a lot of cases now with Edison and SDG&E and PG&E. And then outside of the U.S., outside of California, a lot of states don't have net energy metering, kind of like Hawaii now. So you're actually, payback is really good in those cases. But you're not sending energy back to the grid from your solar. You're just charging the battery and avoiding those high costs and keeping your solar power. So that's how it works if you don't have net energy metering. If your battery gets full, you're kind of wasting your solar at that point. It's still going to your house possibly, but your battery's full. But then if your house doesn't need all that solar power, it just doesn't produce any more power that is being used. So, you know, you do waste a little bit of power, but it's generally better than paying high rates and not having a battery where, you know, you don't have any power at night now that you're using from your solar, because you don't have a battery or net energy metering to let your meter spin backwards and store that power. So, so it can work really good in those situations. So yeah, thanks for watching. Make sure to check out the video on Hawaii and my intro video about why the solar truth is here. And we'll see you next time.